In this video, I'm going to show you what Trevor Jacob does not want you to see. He recently edited his viral video and removed about 4 minutes of footage. What he removed just builds the case against him. First, I'd like to address Trevor Jacob directly. Stop. Just stop. Everything you do just digs your grave deeper. My advice to you is to take your YouTube ad revenue and hire yourself a really good lawyer, and hopefully you can get off of life in prison. I would strongly suggest you use the defense that you're suffering from brain damage caused by CTE, which is a result of all your snowboarding concussions. It's really your only hope of getting out of life in prison. Okay, so let's get on to what Trevor Jacob does not want you to see. His original video is 16 minutes 41 seconds, his edited version, 12 minutes 53 seconds. What he did was remove the beginning and the end of the video. And we're gonna look at what is in the beginning and end that he does not want you to see, because it's very insightful. First, he removed that whole cringeworthy plug for Ridge Wallets at the beginning of his video. None of his other videos have this. Now, let me ask you this. So, you have a plug for Ridge Wallets where you make 25% of everything that is purchased using that code. Why on earth would he edit his video to remove such an amazing income source? Could it possibly be because it indicates that before he even took off, he knew that something really big was going to happen that he could cash in on? Again, none of his other videos have this plug at the beginning. Then, the spreading of the ashes. The whole premise of this video is that he's flying to Mammoth to honor his friend by spreading his ashes. And then he holds up a used sandwich bag holding the ashes of his friend. Now, is that how you would like to be respected? In a used sandwich bag? I don't think so. Okay, let's get to the funniest thing of all, in my opinion. There was no safe place to land. Well, with the help of others on YouTube, we located the exact position where his engine failure occurred. I flew to that position, precisely that location, that altitude, with my airplane that had virtually identical glide characteristics to the Taylor craft he was flying. First of all, the riverbed directly below had numerous safe places to land. Even funnier than that, though, was that Santa Ynez Airport was within gliding distance. I actually showed that having a power failure where he did, I was able to glide to the Santa Ynez Airport and overfly it at 3,000 feet. What that means is because I have a glide of 9 to 1, meaning I can go forward 9 miles for every mile altitude I have, I could have flown another 4 miles further. So I'm curious why Jacob does not consider an airport a safe place to land. Makes you wonder, huh? During the flight, I experienced an engine failure. Really? Where was your restart attempt? Now, a lot of people who are not pilots jump in at this point trying to defend him and say maybe he panicked. What you don't realize is that a huge part of pilot training, even for a private pilot license, is emergency procedures. I can tell you that my CFI, Certified Flight Instructor, virtually every flight, he would pull the power and say, to simulate an engine failure, and say, what you gonna do now? And I was expected to establish best glide, to locate a forced landing field, to go through the engine restart procedure, to call for help, all those things. No flight instructor is going to sign off on a pilot who cannot do these emergency procedures with confidence. Now, why is it that he didn't seem to do any of those? The only thing I can think of is that he knew he was out of gas, because if you're out of gas, there is no reason to do a restart procedure. Just saying. I notified the FAA and the NTSB immediately. Really? Because there's sources at the Lompoc Airport that seem to disagree with this. According to this article, Trevor did not plan on reporting it to the FAA and the NTSB until he was told he had to. At this point, rumor has it he panicked and hired a helicopter to remove the airplane wreckage, which contained all the incriminating evidence. Okay, so that's the intro. Now, everything in the middle 12 minutes, 53 seconds is exactly the same. That's what he left in the edited version. So we're going to just zip through that really fast here. And then it gets to the end, the cringeworthy segment where he spreads the ashes as his sign of respect. Now, honestly, I can't bear to watch this, so I'm going to let you watch it and draw your own conclusions. Thanks for watching. Auf Wiedersehen.
It's been a few days since the crash, covered head to toe in poison oak. We are on the road about 4 hours into the drive, just hoping to get there and have enough time to get some sleep. So we'll wake up first thing in the morning and start hiking the mountain to spread Johnny's ashes on one of his favorite mountains in the Sierra Nevadas. This is the goal and intention that I set before even embarking on this adventure, and there's nothing that's going to stop me from following through with that.
Good morning from about 9,000 feet. We're just hiking up this ridge line here. Got the paraglider on my back, got the wonderful Johnny Strange's ashes with us in my pocket. We're gonna hike to the top and spread some of those and paraglide off. All right, we have officially made it to the top. What a beautiful day. Johnny, I know you're here with us, man. I want to express gratitude. I'm gonna just pour some out in my hand. On a count of three to Johnny. One, two, three. Love you, Johnny! Johnny, let's have a great flight down, man.
All right, well, we got the paraglider all laid out.
It's a beautiful day. We just spread Johnny's ashes. And we are ready to go.
Now you're with me.